Good morning. Welcome to our fourth online service for Lowville Mennonite Church. My name is Keith Zayer. I'm the senior pastor here. It is Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday is a day that brings a conflict of emotion, joy and sorrow at the same time. We'll be talking about that as the morning goes on. This is also Lenten service number 6, our final Lenten service prior to Easter, and we are down to one candle left on our display. For call to worship this morning, I will read some verses from Psalm 118, and your responsive part, when I give you the signal, is God's faithful love endures forever. Once again, God's faithful love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my song, and has given me victory. Songs of joy and victory are sung in the camp of the godly. The strong right arm of the Lord has done glorious things. I will live to tell what the Lord has done. Open for me the gates where the righteous enter, and I will go in and thank the Lord. These gates lead to the presence of the Lord, and the godly enter there. I thank you for answering my prayer. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Bless the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. You are my God, and I will praise you. Give thanks to the Lord, whose faithful love endures forever. And we all say together, God's faithful love endures forever. Join us now in singing as Marvin Zayer will lead us.
Connie Zayer, pastor of Care and Nurture at Lowville Mennonite Church. When we first started this physical distancing thing, we weren't quite sure how it was going to happen. We thought, there's no way we can stay in our house for a week. Within a few weeks now, it's getting longer and longer, so we don't have any idea what's going to happen. And I still find myself thinking of how it was before this happened. When I'm organizing something, I found a book that I was going to give to someone, and I thought, well, I'll just go drop it off to them. I can't go visiting. Or I heard of one of my young friends who was getting very frustrated because he was used to not having so many people around his house all the time, and he couldn't find a place to be by himself. So I thought, well, I'll have him come for a play date. Well, that won't work either, because we can't do that. So we have to do things differently. Now, some of the people, there are some people who are doing things, when they're doing things differently, it's because they, okay, I'm going to just start over. Hello, I'm Connie Zaire, pastor of Care and Nurture at Lowville Mennonite Church. Thinking about this physical distancing, when we started doing it, we were not quite sure it was going to happen. We thought, there's no way we can stay in our house for a week or a couple of weeks, and now it's getting longer and longer. And it's just totally switching the way we do things. I was doing some organizing, and I found a book that I had planned on giving to someone, and I thought, oh, I'll take this over to them now. Well, I can't do that because I can't go visiting. Or I heard of one of my young friends who was getting very frustrated because he was used to having some space by himself, not having all of his family at home all the time. So I thought, oh, well, I'll have him over for a play date. But that doesn't work either because we need to stay away from people. So we are learning to do things differently. There are a lot of people who are doing things differently, and they are busier than ever because they're helping to keep us safe, or they're helping to get us the things that we need and taking care of us. And we always want to be sure and thank those people for doing that. But a lot of us are at home with our families, and we're doing things that that we wouldn't normally do. So some of the things that we're starting to do, the new things, are good. And some of the things that we used to do that we're not doing, it's a good thing we're not doing them. So I hope that we'll be able to, well, I don't want to say when we're back to normal, because who knows what normal is going to look like. So I'll just say after this. After this is over, I hope that we will remember some of the good things that we have learned. One of the new things that I have done this past week is I took a yoga lesson. I have a niece and nephew in Indiana who have a yoga studio, and they are doing lessons online now due to the quarantine. In fact, you can go to Spacious Heart Yoga online and find it, and it's quite a good experience. I now know what this downward dog is that everyone's been talking about. I don't think I have time to give you a demonstration of it now. Maybe later, I don't know. I don't know what new thing I will do next week to top that, but let's keep trying to do new things. In Isaiah 43:18-19, it says, "Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old." I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the desert. I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. So as we're thinking about new things and old things, I hope that we'll remember which things that we want to keep with us and continue doing after this. But it's hard for us to do new things and enjoy doing new things because we're still afraid. This is a scary time. And so it's hard to enjoy doing those things. You know, when we're afraid, it's because we are thinking about a bunch of things that might happen. And they might not really happen, but when we think about it, we start imagining all these different things that could happen, and we get more and more stressed out. I want to read Isaiah 41:10 says, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Now, I want to show you something here. Here I have this nice dish. This vase represents our bodies. So our body is right there. This baking soda is going to represent things that we fear, things we're afraid of, like snakes, spiders, mice, the dark, flying, being too high, being too closed in. Maybe we're afraid of getting sick. We're afraid of someone we love getting sick. All of these things are in there. Now, when we have all of these fears inside of us, it makes us really nervous and stressful, and it's really not even good for our bodies because our body can't perform and do the things that we need to do. So now this vinegar is going to represent Jesus. And Jesus is coming along. If we ask Jesus to help take away our fears, look what happens. Oh, Jesus is in there and he's pushing those fears out. So we don't have to be afraid of things. Now, you can see that there's still baking soda in there. The fears are not all gone. But another thing we can do to take care, to help our fears is to talk to someone that we love about it. I find if I'm afraid of something, if I just talk to somebody about it or write it down or do something else to acknowledge it, then it can make me feel better. But we still have these fears in here. So we ask Jesus to come in again, and he's going to help take care of that. You know, we're humans, and just as human beings, we will always have some fear in us. There's never going to be a time when we're not afraid of anything. In fact, some fear is good because it helps us to not do things that are dangerous. So we just need to keep remembering, though, if you're afraid of something, you talk about it to someone, you pray about it, ask Jesus to help you, and that will help take some of the fear out of you. Oh, wait, just a minute. What are you saying? You're saying that I've already done this? Oh dear, you think that I can't, you think I have no new ideas, so I'm just using another one that I've already done? Actually, I did this over 3 weeks ago. The first time that we couldn't be together in church, I showed that to you, how to take care of your fears. And now, I'm doing it again. Why? Because we ask Jesus one time to take away our fear, or just because we tell a person one time about what we're afraid of, that doesn't mean that it's going to be gone. We will continue hearing about things that make us afraid. So we need to continue telling other people about it and asking Jesus to help us with it. So the other thing that we want to do now is, it is Palm Sunday today. Normally when we are at church, we all get a palm branch and we wave it around, and we're doing this because we're celebrating Jesus walking through the town on the donkey, and everyone was so excited. So, well, it's not quite like this. They did not have these, but this would be what you would do if you were excited. Palms. Well, I guess you can figure out why these palms are at Mimi's house and not at Evelyn and Valerie's house. If you can't figure that out, you can ask their parents. Anyway, but here we have Jesus going on the donkey, and his friends are so excited because they think he's going to be king and take care of all the problems that they have. They're not realizing what's going to happen in the next week. a sort of like when you, if you're playing with your a group of friends, and you're all excited, and each of you get more and more excited, and you're more noisy, and you're doing more things, and you're having so much fun, and then a grown-up says, "Now you need to settle down. Be careful, or someone will get hurt." Or they might say, "If you break your leg, don't come running to me." Anyway, they're telling you to quiet down, but you just can't. It's more and more exciting, so you get more and more excited, and then someone gets hurt. Oh, and then it's no fun anymore at all. And that's what it's like. Palm Sunday, they were so excited for Jesus. And soon, it's going to be Good Friday, and it's a totally different story then, which we will talk about next week, but that is why we're doing Palm Sunday now. So I hope that you have seen the YouTube video that the Hauser family put together about making these palm branches. I had a lot of fun doing it. Now, you know, I don't have little people at my house anymore, so I used my grand dog Millie's paws down the middle. I quite like my palm branch here. Now, what we're going to do is Marvin and his family are going to lead us in the song Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. And when you have your branches, wave your branches as we're singing Hosanna. If you didn't get a chance to make a branch, or you don't have anything like that around, just use whatever you have, like a blanket or a pillow, a shirt, a towel, anything you have, and just wave those branches as we are singing Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. Now, before we do that, we're going to do our prayer. Remember, now you repeat after me, and at the end, after our second, we say amen, and then we say amen, and clap together like that. Okay, so you repeat after me. Jesus, you came as a man, but you are more than a man. There is no one like you. You are Jesus Christ, our Lord. Glory be to God. Amen. Amen.
Associate Pastor here at Lowville Mennonite Church, and I will be having the pastoral prayer this morning. I want to mention a few things, although not mentioning anybody by name, but just mentioning that there has been a person in the congregation who suffered a mini stroke this week and is now recovering. There's also the sister of a member of our congregation who was pregnant, had a high-risk pregnancy, and was induced at 28 weeks. She and the baby are doing okay at the moment. We also have the niece of a member who was at high risk for COVID-19 and being tested. I imagine that there might be many others, relatives or friends that we know of, who might be at risk and different places in different ways. So we want to certainly think of them. And also, we have had exchange students staying with families here who now have been forced to leave early and go back to be with their families. We remember them and their families and their host families as well. If there's anything else on your mind this morning, we certainly invite you to lift these things in prayer. I will have a short silence where we can remember these things, and then I will be praying from Hymnal Worship Book number 730. This was the prayer that Keith prayed with our first online service a few weeks ago, and he started reading it, and I thought, was that written for this time? So I want to read that again, because even though it was written years ago, it does seem to really apply to our time right now. So let's have some silence, and then I'll close that with prayer. Most gracious God, protect us from worry about the concerns of this life, so that we will not become entangled by them, from the needs of our bodies, so that we will not be enslaved by desires, and from any hindrance to our spirits, so that we will not be defeated by troubles. Give us strength to resist, patience to endure, and steadfastness to persevere. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I'll be sharing a few reflections this morning. Today is the day known in the church as Palm Sunday, and I have to confess, and maybe I feel more free to do this because of the more informal nature of these videos, but I have to confess that Palm Sunday is one of my least favorite Sundays of the year. Making Palm Sunday into a big church celebration just kind of feels wrong. And it's not all wrong, but it's not quite right either, so stick with me here. Because I'm not trying to say that making and waving palm branches and yelling, Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, that that's all wrong either. I'm not trying to knock that. I even appeared in a video that Nicole starred in to show how to make palm branches from cutout handprints so they could be waved on Palm Sunday. But what I want to share is some of my struggle with it all. It seems to me like celebrating Palm Sunday is a bit like a basketball player who steals the ball and has a solo breakaway down court. He goes up for the big dunk, and when he comes down, he throws up his hands, does some kind of big celebration. But in the meantime, his teammates are scrambling to get the ball because he missed the dunk. Or maybe it's like a football player that makes some huge 90-yard run downfield, and he sticks out the football and drops it as he crosses the goal line. He runs around and does some big celebration while all the other team has jumped on the ball because the ball never actually crossed the goal line for the touchdown. Now, I'm sorry if it's hard to visualize these sports analogies right now in these days of no live sports, but Palm Sunday feels a bit to me like a premature celebration. Now, it is right to celebrate Jesus, and the people were not wrong to celebrate Jesus coming to Jerusalem. He was about to do something that would change the world forever. He is the King of all, and to greet him with branches and coats on the road like they greeted kings at that time was not wrong. Yet their celebration was a bit premature, it was a bit off the mark. They were praising Jesus because they thought he was riding into town like a warrior king or a general, ready to vanquish their enemies and restore the nation of Israel as a nation state free from Roman rule. I think of a Hollywood Western with John Wayne or Clint Eastwood riding into town and everyone gathering around him, standing on the boardwalk sidewalks, waiting for him to meet the bad guy and his gang, anticipating that he will send them all away and save their little town from the tyranny of the evil silver miner. But that is not the kind of savior that Jesus is. We know that Jesus will not violently face off against the baddies and send them back to Rome with their tails between their legs. Jesus certainly faces violence, but he's on the receiving end. He is the one that is struck down. He is the one knocked off his horse, beaten, forced into submission, tied up, dragged through the streets and killed in a public display of Rome's gruesome form of justice. And what's more, the people that were shouting Hosanna and praising Jesus as he rode into the city days earlier are now likely part of the mass of people shouting, crucify, crucify him. how quickly the popular opinion of Jesus shifted. The people expected him to come in and mount a coup against the Roman occupation, and he didn't do that. He didn't live up to their expectations, and so they turned on him. So on Palm Sunday, I can't help but think about all of what is coming up for Jesus in the next few days. Unfortunately, in our churches, we often celebrate the celebration of Palm Sunday, and then we gather a week later and celebrate the resurrection of Jesus on Easter Sunday. But we can't gloss over what happens in between. I'm a firm believer that Jesus' resurrection is more important than his death. Yet neither one tells the whole story on its own. To fully appreciate the resurrection, I think we need to acknowledge and sit with the passion of Jesus. And that is his arrest, his trial, his beating, crucifixion, and death. To coincide with Holy Week, that would be Thursday evening through Sunday morning. And in a normal season of Lent, I might just leave things here. But this isn't a normal season. And since you are hopefully comfortable on your couches right now, I'll go on a bit longer. I find myself much closer to tears these days than normal. And if you know me well, you might be thinking, is that even possible? When I hear about what is happening in our nation and around the world in relation to COVID-19, it is emotional. Thousands of people have died from this virus, and thousands more are projected to. At this point, I would not be surprised if most of us have 1 or 2 degrees of separation from someone that actually has or has had COVID-19. The large-scale impact of this is ever present with us. And I wonder if in this time of mourning for the health of our nation and our world, we might be more able to mourn the suffering and death of Jesus. The thing is, we know that he is not dead. We know that Easter is coming. We don't need to refuse to believe in the resurrection until Easter morning. That hope of new life does not leave us. But I wonder if we could find the reason for hope to be a little stronger this year. We have a unique opportunity this year to soak in Holy Week, not through different kinds of gatherings to commemorate like we normally might do, but rather because we might be able to slow down a little more and reflect, as we don't have the same kind of activity going on around us. Pastor Lori from Lowville Presbyterian Church will be leading a Praying of the Hours starting Thursday at 6 on her church's Facebook page. The Lowville clergy group will be presenting, likely on YouTube, a video on Good Friday. And we here at Lowville Mennonite are trying to present a way of for people to participate in the Remembering the Cross opportunity that we often do in our church, trying to do that somehow at home. Now, these are all opportunities, but what you do with them or how you choose to interact with Holy Week is up to you. It is about what is meaningful to you. So ask God to direct you through this time. Don't allow me or anyone else to tell you how exactly you should be using this time, but rather seek God's direction for this time for you. One of the struggles that I see happening is that because information can be passed so easily, we are getting an overload of it. Our very own Keith Zayer made the following comment on Facebook. He wrote, "As a pastor, I'm finding myself getting weary just from reading all the suggestions for what to do over this time. In my cynical moments, I often think many of us are trying to prove to others and convince ourselves that we're needed when deep down we fear we may not be needed much at all." I just did his sermon there for him. He can thank me later, I guess. But let me tie that in with an article from PBS.org entitled "Parenting During Coronavirus, You Are Enough" by Rebecca Parlakian. And I shared this on my Facebook page actually too. You may have seen it this week. The article encouraged parents to remember that they are enough. Not every day will go smoothly. Not everything will come out right. There will be frustrations and missed expectations for you and your children. But what you are doing is enough, regardless of what you read from any other experts or parents. You are enough, and you are needed because you are a human being made in the image of God. You have value and therefore worth, because you are loved by God. We don't need to prove anything to anyone, including ourselves, during this time. But let us continue to show love and positivity in every way that we can. And that might be making fun videos or doing neat crafts or sending letters or hanging posters in our windows. It might be praying silently by ourselves for whoever God puts on our hearts. Or it might be anything else that God directs us to. We will not always get it right. And perhaps that is something that I need to learn from Palm Sunday too. The people that laid their branches before Jesus didn't get it completely right. They had it partially right, but not completely. And Jesus didn't abandon them in that. He continued to follow the way of God, and he showed his passion for God and for humanity through the events of the forthcoming week. And this attitude of Jesus is summed up well in Philippians 2, 5 to 11. I won't read that now, but I would encourage you to at some point. I hope that we, in this season of our lives, and in this season of Lent, can find God at work, and can find a centeredness in him. Jesus experienced the high of exaltation and the low of rejection. We can praise him for both, and for all of who he is. Just as he experienced tremendous lows during Passion Week, he can guide us through the lows that we might be experiencing right now too. And just as he brought a salvation far greater than the masses of people with their palm branches anticipated, so can he bring us through to something far better than we even now might realize. So it might be the start of Passion Week, but take heart, for Easter is a-coming.
Lives of God.
Will you now join me in the confession? Your response will be, Lord, have mercy. O God, we come to you as the people who greeted Jesus on the road to Jerusalem, full of joy and praise and thanksgiving. Forgive us for the times we forget to show you our gratitude. We come as the people who were baffled when they realized how quickly their joy was turned to sorrow for you. We come wanting to be with you as you enter the time and place of your death, knowing we cannot face this week alone. And together, Lord, have mercy. I will now give assurance of pardon. Know that Jesus does offer mercy and understands that hard road between joy and devastation, between belief and disbelief. Know that Jesus will never leave you and will love you on whatever part of the road you find yourself on right now. Amen.
This is a panoramic view of the top of the property here at the Maple Ridge Center. We're looking out over the valley. What you're seeing is the Jefferson Community College building, which was just constructed here. Classes are being held there. There's also some people walking on the track. We've had a lot of people that are walking on this track to get some time away and to have some private time together. This is the pond that used to be used to train horses, and what you're looking at is a 5/8 mile track. 5/8 mile is the distance that my favorite racetrack is, and if you can imagine an open cockpit supermodified race car with an 800 horsepower motor getting around this track in 15 seconds or less, well, that's truly something amazing to think about. And then we have some more buildings over here to the left. Now, what could be bad about this property? Well, it's expensive. We did not pay anything to get the property. We do own it free and clear, but there's a lot of maintenance that needs to happen on a regular basis. Financially, it's been a bit of a strain on the finances of the Adirondack Mennonite Camping Association, but at the same time, we are making more progress each year, and we are looking forward to the day when we are going to be in the black. The good part is all of this acreage, it will soon be teeming with green grass and wildlife. Just a beautiful property, and it has so much potential. We're very happy to have it as part of our organization, Adirondack Mennonite Camping Association.
This sermon this morning is being brought to you from the grounds of the Maple Ridge Center, just outside Lowville on the East Road. I am recording this on the Saturday before Palm Sunday, but you're seeing it hopefully on Palm Sunday if you're tuning in live this morning. Our text is from Matthew chapter 21, verses 9 through 11. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" And the crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus of Nazareth from Galilee." I've entitled this sermon this morning, "The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly," and all three of those elements are in this story today. It has nothing to do with the song or the movie from that title. The good being that this was a chance for people to show their adoration and praise to Jesus as he was riding into Jerusalem. The bad being that the Roman authority was now suddenly alerted as to the power that he had, and there's evidence that the Roman government may have been staging a parade of their own just on the other side of town, very close to the same time that Jesus was riding in. The ugly, of course, being his beating and arrest and crucifixion during what we will be celebrating this next week as Holy Week. I'm going to give you a tour of the Maple Ridge Center here and a few spots on the property and talk about the good and the bad of each section. What you're seeing behind me is our snow tubing hill. It's a little windy out here today. It's almost always windy at the Maple Ridge Center. I hope you can hear me okay. This hill was, believe it or not, just 4 weeks ago, Sunday, March 9th, still had enough snow on it to slide down on a snow tube. That was our last day of operation. It was later that week that we learned of the spread of the coronavirus and some of the social distancing that needed to take place. Now here we are on Palm Sunday, and we are observing what we have to observe today. Now, the bad part about this hill is how long it took us to get going. We thought we weren't going to be able to construct it. We actually had a grant that we had to return to a foundation because we weren't getting anywhere and putting the equipment up, and it didn't look feasible. Well, eventually we decided we were going to try it. We were able to get the grant back, which was fortunate. But even then, those first couple years of operation were difficult. We had some inspections from the New York State Department of Labor that we had to satisfy, and we were not that busy. For the first couple of years, I'm pretty sure we operated at a pretty serious loss. However, these last 2 years have been very profitable for the Maple Ridge Snow Park, as we like to call it. We had almost 5,000 visitors this year. We had a good snow tubing season, and one of our Facebook posts, oh, there we go, there's that wind blowing again. One of our Facebook posts actually got 20,000 hits as we were talking about our snow tubing season here. So it's been a great year, families have had a great time, and some of our young employees here have been the best. Now, perhaps you've heard what is often said about this younger generation. They don't have a very good work ethic, they don't have a very good understanding of how to behave. Well, I have three words for that: wrong, wrong, wrong. These young people that worked on this snow tubing hill this past winter were fantastic. I wish we could hire them all permanently. They were very companionable and friendly to all of the staff that came here. They were hardworking to all of our customers that came here. And we had had so many positive comments about how much fun it is for families to be on this hill and about how helpful the staff is. So this is a good part of our functioning here at the Maple Ridge Center, and it helps winter go by a lot faster. Trust me on that one. This is our maple project at the Maple Ridge Center. Once again, we're struggling with the wind a little bit. The picture's going to be a little shaky. I would not call this good versus bad, but perhaps scarcity versus abundance. When Beaver Camp first started in 1969, we had some maple producers that would donate enough maple syrup to get us through the year. Well, as Beaver Camp grew and more guests came onto the property, it was no longer possible for maple producers to do that. So when I started working at the camp in 2006, one of my jobs was to see that we had enough maple syrup for the auction, that we had enough for our summer program, as well as guest groups that came in. It was a bit of a challenge. We had to purchase a lot of maple syrup.
So years later, when a beloved member of our community passed away, he was a maple producer here in Lewis County, and his family left his family and friends from the memorial service left a donation toward Beaver Camp, and we asked the family if they would like it to be used for a maple sap collection system to make maple syrup. And they agreed to that right away and provided some additional funding. So what you're seeing is the tank on the hill and all of these tubes. There's 550 taps on the maple trees on the back of the Maple Ridge Center property. It flows into this tank and then it's pumped off down the hill and it's taken down the road and boiled into maple syrup. So now we have gone from a scarcity of not having enough syrup to even operate Beaver Camp to having a phenomenal abundance. We have enough for Beaver Camp, we have enough for Maple Ridge, and we have enough to sell to you if you would like some. And the 2020 crop is in. We have gone from scarcity to abundance in just a matter of a couple years when it comes to maple syrup from the Maple Ridge property. So, we have all these conflicting emotions on Palm Sunday. We have scarcity versus abundance. We have joy versus sorrow. In a sense, we have good, bad, and ugly. Which is it for you this past week and during these times when we're in this unique time in our history? There's a lot of bad that we could talk about, but I bet there's some good too. And the wind is blowing again. This is one of the windiest spots here in the Maple Ridge Center property, but we were determined to at least let you see the sign in the entrance. Or snow park. I guarantee you there are probably some good things coming out of this if we dig deep enough to think about them. One of the things that is another conflict is the desire to be productive over this time versus taking time for rest and relaxation. We talked about this a couple weeks ago, but I'm talking about it again because now the media seems to be picking up on it. One of our major newspapers has this advice for us: stop trying to be productive. Everyone's talking about all that extra time, but in the midst of a pandemic, there is no need to be an overachiever. That's my last word to you this morning. We mentioned it a couple weeks ago as a suggestion. This morning, I'm going to give it to you as an imperative. Please take time to rest and relax this week if you can. Some of you can't because of your job. You're probably working harder than you've ever worked before. But these are not ordinary times. And these were not ordinary times when Jesus rode into Jerusalem. That was a very significant moment in history, and it led to the greatest of all historical events with God revealing himself to his people through the resurrection. So I ask you, Holy Week is one of the best times to relax, to rest, to have a Sabbath, to contemplate. All those projects around the house that you feel you need to get done, you don't. Let's rest and relax and appreciate Holy Week and the sacrifice, what Jesus meant to us and what that means to us in our lives over this time. Happy Easter, everyone. We hope you have a great week.